So hi, everyone. Today, we're hosting Dr. Cynthia Owsley from the University of Alabama at Birmingham. Dr. Owsley is the Nathan E. Miles Endowed Chair of Ophthalmology at the Department of Ophthalmology and Visual Sciences, where she also directs the Clinical Research Unit. She obtained a PhD in experimental psychology with a focus on visual perception from Cornell University, which she followed this degree with a postdoctoral fellowship in visual psychophysics and aging at Northwestern University. She also later obtained a Master of Science in Public Health from UAB. The core of Dr. Owsley's research lies very close to the patient and to their experience of visual changes and in that way, she's rather unique in the field. Her research considers several aspects of functional changes and how we can intervene to mitigate them. These include functional changes that are associated with aging and ocular diseases. And she's also monitored how these changes affect the quality of life of those affected. She has also given specific attention to vulnerable and underserved populations in ophthalmology. I'll mention a work on functional biomarkers in age-related macular degeneration, which is very far-reaching and influential. She has shown that rod function was particularly impaired in AMD, and that delays in rod-mediated dark adaptation could be used as a biomarker of incidence of AMD. She'll talk more to this later in her research talk, which is at 1, which I very strongly recommend for you to attend. But as part of her research, she has also explored the relationship between vision and driving, with the goal of translating some of her findings into public policies. And I'm very excited to hear her tell us more about this. So please join me in welcoming her for this talk. Thank you.
Thank you so much for inviting me for these two talks today. This morning, I'm gonna focus on vision impairment, focusing on older drivers. And the reason our research program focuses on older drivers is that vision impairment is so much more prevalent in this population. You can have vision impairment, of course, at any age if you're a driver. And we have done some research on younger drivers using bioptic telescopes, people who have hemianopia. But today I'm going to be focusing almost entirely on older drivers. These are my funding sources. So the two topics I'm going to address today is first looking at the question of how we can visually screen for motor vehicle collision risk at motor vehicle administrations. As you know, in all states, in order to get a license, you have to have visual acuity screen. I'll talk about this more in a moment. But the question, there's really very important questions as to whether visual screening is really worthwhile in terms of meeting a safety goal, making sure you're minimizing collision risk. The second topic I'm going to address today is using naturalistic driving methods. This is where equipment is actually embedded in older drivers' vehicles, their own vehicle, and then they drive around. It's video vehicle kinematics, and we can get really a hands-on, really objective method about how they're driving and looking at this in terms of collision risk. So first, looking at vision screening. So first, I want to point out that there's really many methods for studying driving, particularly older drivers. And Jerry McGuinn and Joanne Wood and I kind of summarized this literature in the Survey of Ophthalmology. But essentially, here are the major ways you can study driving, particularly from a visual standpoint. So you can look at driver safety, motor vehicle collisions. These are usually expressed as rate in terms of how many collisions you have per person miles of travel or person years of driving. And in these situations, you get accident reports actually from the state. So it's sort of like an objective record, sort of like a death certificate. And it has, I'll show you an example in a moment, all the details. If you've ever had a collision, you've been able to see one of these reports from the state, if in fact the police officers reported it to the state. The second way we can study older drivers is looking at their driver performance, actually looking at behaviors in vehicle kinematics when a person operates a vehicle on a roadway. And you can look at this both in open and closed roadway designs. This is a very popular technique in some parts of the country, and I'll get back to that in a moment. Another way we can study drivers is sort of analogous to patient-reported outcomes. We can use driver-reported outcomes, meaning questionnaires. And these are asking older drivers, please self-report your types of driving experiences, your attitudes, your beliefs, where you think you're having problems, where you're not having problems. And these, of course, are collected through structured questionnaires. And there's many of these questionnaires out there. And then a final way we can study driving is using driving simulators. And it's important to keep in mind that what these are scenarios and driving tests that are presented via visual display. And then they're designed as laboratory representations of what's going on in the real world. And I'll talk a little bit about the strengths and limitations of this approach as well. So let's get back to visual acuity. So visual acuity is a screening requirement in all states in the United States and many countries throughout the world. In most states, the screening, the minimum acuity you can have is 24 to 40, sometimes 20/30, although there are exceptions. For example, in my state, you can drive at 20/60. Many states have visual field requirements, and they're actually in their legislative statutes. They're variable in extent, they're variable in how they measure it. And in fact, even in some states, such as Alabama, we don't really screen for visual field. There's a statute about it, but it's never screened for. So in terms of getting your license and going back in for rescreening, the timing of license renewal really varies among states. In some states, it's actually limited by age. In other words, you don't start having to have visual acuity screened again until you're, say, 60 or 70. In some states, they do it randomly with those age groups. But in some states, every time you go in for a license renewal, they screen visual acuity. And what the real research issue here is, decades of research, literally decades of research, have really failed to find a relationship between visual acuity and safety. Most of these study designs have been weak. They have not been population-based. They have not been using what we would consider the clinically acceptable, valid, reliable vision tests. So why was 2040 accepted by so many states? This is basically because 2040, as deemed by the Federal Highway Administration, part of the US Department of Transportation, it was selected years ago as, because this is the ability to read road signs, for example, on an interstate or a state road, and an appropriate visibility distance so that you can still stop the vehicle. So that's why we ended up with 2040. We didn't end up with 2040 because there was safety data, motor vehicle collision data, suggesting that this is where your collision rate jumps up if you have worse than 2040. So vision is obviously very important for driving. So why is really there no association between visual acuity and motor vehicle collisions? So one reason, and there's probably many reasons for this, drivers with poor acuity in some cases stop driving, either voluntarily or involuntarily. Perhaps their physician, their ophthalmologist or optometrist reports them to the state, and then the license is eventually revoked. There may actually be an association between acuity and motor vehicle collision risk, but it has a minor role in the sense that it only occurs in very severe deficits, for example, worse than 2200. So to say that acuity has nothing to do with driver safety is a little bit incorrect. It's because we really don't study drivers who are, say, have 2200, 2500. The thing they also keep in mind is the collisions really are multifactorial in their causes. Many things can cause collisions. Other medical conditions, for example, dementia or cognitive impairment, environmental factors on the roadway, and also vehicle factors. And in many cases, if I'm the driver and I have a collision, it's not because I did anything, it's because the other driver or drivers did something. And so finally, it's important to remember that visual acuity is really, in my mind, an inadequate representation of the visual skills you need for driving. Other things are also important. For example, peripheral vision, visual search, visual attention, motion perception, contrast sensitivity, all these things seem like they would be important. And in seeing, having excellent spatial resolution may be important for reading a sign at a distance down the road, but it's not really, from what the research suggests, it's not really important for not running into a large object in the roadway, which is dominated, of course, by low spatial frequencies. So many people think that if we identify visual impairment risk factors, for example, in population-based studies or convenience samples, that they would be good screening tests to be used at the DMV. And I think this is basically what the study I'm going to describe to you has looked at. Just because you have an elevated risk doesn't mean that it would be a useful screening test. As I already mentioned, vision impairment is much more prevalent in older drivers, and that's why we focus on it. And so no study prior to ours using a population-based approach has effectively addressed whether different types of vision screening tests could be used to identify crash-prone older drivers. In other words, drivers not who had a history of crash involvement, but who are threats on the road going into the future prospectively. So here's our study design. We studied 2,000 drivers in North Central Alabama. And at baseline, what we did was we used a number of different types of vision screening tests. We also confirmed their driver status, looked at their driving exposure, and we'll get back to that in a moment. Then over the subsequent 3 years, we collected, at the very end of that period, we collected their motor vehicle collision data for that three-year period from the Alabama Law Enforcement Agency, which in Alabama is the state agency that where if police report a collision, the accident report is filled out and it's filed there. And you can actually, in most states, I would say in many states, actually get these data from the state with the participant's permission. So during that three-year period, we wanted to make sure people didn't stop driving or die or move to another state so they weren't having collision exposures in Alabama. So we phoned them every year for 3 years to make sure that they were still driving. So the source population is Jefferson County, Alabama. As I mentioned, this is in North Central Alabama. Everybody was 70 years old or older. We're focusing on this range because according to the US Department of Transportation and the National Highway Traffic Safety Administration, this is where the collision rate starts to go up in older drivers. It's not quite as high as the 16 to 25 year old drivers, but it starts to elevate and starts approaching their collision rates. We randomly selected from a list of persons from a direct marketing firm, and then we confirmed it that they were actually licensed in Alabama. We could not use the state motor vehicle record or the state licensing data to recruit the patients because this would be a violation of privacy, but we could use this marketing firm where we could identify these are basically people who've had credit of one type or another over the previous years. But then we could confirm that they were actually still licensed in Alabama. That was allowed. Of course, they had to speak English. They were community living. They weren't living in nursing homes, and they had to have driven in the past 3 months. And as I mentioned, we enrolled 2,000 people. So in terms of the baseline screening tests, we looked at many of the popular candidates that have been looked at in the literature, and we chose these because there was some suggestion in the literature they might elevate collision risk in older drivers. We used visual acuity because this is what the state uses. We also looked at contrast sensitivity, visual field sensitivity using a driving visual field, which I'll mention in a moment, visual processing speed, which is a computerized test. And we also used a paper test for this. And this looks at how quickly you can process information when two targets are presented, whether you can tell them apart, and also the impact of distractors on that. So it's basically in terms of milliseconds, how quickly can you tell two things apart? And we also looked at visual spatial skills because the literature has suggested that these might be important. Now, when we looked at the driving visual field, we didn't, for example, from a Humphrey field analyzer, the 24-2 or the 30-2. We actually looked into the literature and we identified, and we also took a picture in a vehicle of the part of visual field that you actually use when you're looking out your windshield. And this goes to 15 degrees above fixation. It goes 30 degrees below if you also have to pay attention to the dashboard, which in many cases is important. And because of the limitations of the Humphrey visual field, we only went out to 60 degrees. So that's the area of the visual field we actually looked at. We also, previously in the 90s, we developed a driving habits questionnaire. And the purpose of this questionnaire is to assess driving exposure. So we didn't have objective driving exposure information, but we did get self-reports of weekly mileage so we could convert it to annual mileage, because keep in mind, we're trying to understand motor vehicle collision rate per person miles of driving. So in terms of the descriptive results, the mean age was a little over 75. The racial groups were very typical of our population in North Central Alabama, about 80% white, 20% black. These were drivers, about half drove daily, about 75% drove at least 5 days a week. And interestingly, these drivers also had normal cognitive status. There might be some bias. You may not volunteer for a driving study if you suspect you have cognitive problems, but basically in this study, cognitive factors are really not a confounding influence over collision rate. So in terms of the vision impairment, 8% had visual acuity worse than 20/40. How could this be? Well, in Alabama, we don't rescreen for visual acuity. So the only way, if you had worse visual acuity, if you wanted to be, wanted to drive, you could still do that. 7% had impaired contrast sensitivity, 11% slowed visual processing speed, about 15% had impaired spatial cognition, where you had trouble telling whether two objects, one was in front of the other, or what the basic spatial configuration was. And we have no normative data on visual fields or motion perception, simply because we used quartile splits. So we had 2,000 drivers in total over 3 years, they had 359 collisions. 16% of the drivers experienced one or more collisions during that period. So you can get a feeling for the kind of numbers. You have to keep in mind, collisions are what statisticians would call rare events. They're not common events. So the analytic approach we used for using vision tests to identify collision-involved drivers, we used logistic regression. We used to estimate the area under the curve for each vision test. We also used clinical cut points, as well as laboratory-based, basically empirically-based cut points based on the distributions from our older drivers. We used receiver-operator characteristics to identify optimal cut points so that we could specify sensitivity and specificity for each test. And we used Poisson regression to look at the rate ratios for every test. In other words, understanding whether it elevated risk. So the question we're looking at is, well, statistically significant associations between a vision test and motor vehicle collisions lead to high sensitivity and specificity. So here we use the clinical cut points. And so if we look at all these tests, you can see they actually have very poor sensitivity and specificity. If they have high specificity, they have poor sensitivity. We did not see significant associations for unadjusted rate ratios for all the vision tests, adjusting for all the things that are listed on the slide. But with adjustment for many confounding variables, significance did disappear. So we're not finding any risk with clinical cut points. However, when we use the optimal cut point based on the distribution of the data, we see two things. Note sensitivity and specificity is still poor. However, we found significant associations for the unadjusted rate ratios for all the vision tests, except visual acuity that repeats itself from the literature. But after adjusting for confounding variables, we see significance for contrast sensitivity, slowed processing speed, spatial perception, and visual field. But these risks, as you see, they might be statistically significant, but they are low. But again, keep in mind, there are many causes of crashes. And so this is very typical in what we see in the literature for population-based studies, as well as for convenience sample studies. These risks exist, they're real. However, they're low. We also used any combination of these tests to try to beef up the risk ratio. And using any of these tests together or in combination, it didn't really change a whole lot. It was about 2. So in summary, even though we found significant associations between vision impairment and crash involvement, none of the tests had good sensitivity and specificity. And typically in public health, when we talk about screening at a population level, we're looking for sensitivity at least an 80% level or higher. And we certainly did not find that. As mentioned, we did see elevations in risk for a number of visual field tests, as I've already mentioned. But again, visual acuity was definitely inadequate. It was not a risk factor. So a continuing problem that exists in the field is that given if you look at the literature on vision impairment and risk factors, what happens is there's an advocacy for using these risk factors, which happens when ophthalmologists and other researchers, also neurologists, read the literature, and the state legislatures or the policymakers contact them and say, well, all these things are risks. Why don't you consider screening for these at the population level? But as we can see here, these are really tenuous and I would say questionable recommendations that are passed on to medical advisory boards. Because when we look at sensitivity and specificity, it would be basically a poor investment of public health dollars to screen for these vision tests. Okay, so I'll go on to the second part now. I just need to take a drink of water here. Too much flight. Okay. So naturalist, sure, yes.
That last slide, you're saying all of those different things are.
Oh, sure. Absolutely. Sorry. So naturalistic driving techniques. In using these techniques, as I mentioned, personal vehicles of drivers are installed with equipment measuring kinematic variables, also location, also multi-channel video. And then after these devices are installed in the vehicle in these studies, the drivers then drive their vehicles for an extended period of time where objective data can be collected. What can you measure? You can measure a variety of things depending on how long. If you're only measuring for a couple of days, the probability of seeing a crash is probably very unusual. But if you're measuring for a longer period of time, months or years, you could see crashes or something referred to as near crashes where they don't actually have a crash, but almost it happens. You can actually measure rapid accelerations and decelerations, other driving behaviors such as turning and other types of things. All this can be stored, and this is an illustration of the Virginia Tech model. All these can be stored to a hard disk, which is stored in the vehicle, and then you can pick up the hard disk and then extract all the data. So Virginia Tech was really the organization that pioneered this work, first with the 100 car study, which some of you may be aware of, but also what is called the Sharp 2 study, which involved almost 4,000 drivers at several locations in the United States. And I'll mention that in a minute. We also use this technology in a study I'm going to describe to you at UAB called the VIP Older Driver Study. So what is the advantage of naturalistic driving? Well, first of all, in most studies, whether they're convenience samples or population-based studies on crash involvement, the crashes are defined by accident reports from the state. This is an example from Alabama, but accident reports across states look very similar because there are certain data elements that the U.S. Department of Transportation requires that are on these accident reports. A problem with these reports is not all crashes are reported to the police. This is only filled out if a police officer comes to the scene. They're also prone to bias. There's some evidence that when drivers are older, the police officer is less likely to cite them and actually complete an accident report. And driving exposure is defined by self-report in these studies, and it's not objective. Another advantage of naturalistic driving is that it's direct, objective study of driving behavior as it occurs in everyday life. It's not interpreted by a driving rehabilitation specialist. These people are, they're usually called CDRSs. They're often occupational therapists. And as illustrated in the picture here, they go out with a driver and they usually have a checklist or they have some sort of set of criteria they use to evaluate the driving behavior. It's also not evaluated on the actual, it's evaluated on an actual roadway, but it's on a pre-specified course that is usually chosen by the researcher or the CDRS, the rehab specialist. Whereas in naturalistic driving, the driver chooses their own routes in the course of everyday life. They drive when and whenever they want. So that's an important distinction. Another advantage is that it's driving in naturalistic driving is not dependent on the self-report by the driver. The driver might actually say, well, I'm actually a good driver. But what we can do is actually measure the objective behavior. And then finally, we're not dependent on a driving simulator. Now, driving simulators have very important advantages. And I know there's a group here in psychology or brain sciences that do use driving simulators. And they have distinct advantages because they really create a great environment for experimental stimulus and response control. It's also a safe environment. No one's going to get hurt. Now, maybe they might develop some nausea from being in the simulator, but it's a safe environment. The disadvantage is even though in the most sophisticated simulators, the visual displays are as good as they can be, they're obvious oversimplification of the complexity of the real world driving environment. Drivers are also well aware that they're not really driving. So they don't have to have a lot of, they don't basically have the same risk perception they have when they're driving actually on a roadway. So it's important to keep in mind why naturalistic driving would be important. So the 100 car study was the first naturalistic driving study. And as I mentioned, this was done by Virginia Tech. And this is just an illustration of their first venture into this area. It was basically just a proof of concept study. It was 100 vehicles of ordinary drivers. They didn't seek out anybody with specific medical conditions. They just found 100 people who would enroll in the study. As mentioned, it was an unobtrusive data collection system. There were no instructions to the drivers. They drove about a year And they drove altogether about 2 million vehicle miles of drive 200 vehicle miles of driving. And the reason this is a really important proof of concept study, they generated many extreme cases of driving behaviors. And you can actually, for a long time, they were available on YouTube. You could probably still look them up and watch these, and they basically blank out the face of the driver. The Sharp 2 study basically came out of the 100 car study. And it was a sample from six different sites. They tried to do population-based screening, but in the end, they also used advertisements. These are some of the criteria. The drivers in this study drove up for 2 years with the equipment in their car. And as you can see here, about 3,500 drivers from age 16 all the way up to 98. This data is publicly available for anybody who's interested in vision and driving, and you can get it through Virginia Tech. Prior to driving, they also did a large battery of tests, and they did include vision as one of the things they measured. They measured various vision tests, and I'll come back to this. The problem with the Sharp 2 study is the vast majority of people had good vision, even the older drivers. So if you're like me and like my research group, you're interested in visual impairment risk factors for crash involvement, this study has some limitations. You can't really identify risks if you don't have people with impaired vision. And the other problem is they use many choices for vision tests that many researchers, at least in vision science, would not consider the most reliable and valid to use. So based on that, we did a study called the VIP Older Driver Study. And what our major reaction is we wanted to include people who were visually impaired. In other words, people who had various eye conditions that caused various vision impairments. Yet we also wanted to enroll normally sighted older drivers. And in other words, we wanted to overcome what we viewed as a major problem of Sharp 2 for understanding vision and driving. So this time we conducted the study ourselves right in Alabama using the Sharp 2 devices. So we recruited patients who were seen at the Callahan Eye Clinic. That's the academic clinic of the UAB Department of Ophthalmology. And as you can see here, it was a vivid brochure. We sent this to people. We identified them through the clinic. And you'll also notice the huge honorarium. Keep in mind, these people were going to be observed in their own personal vehicles for 6 months. So we needed to make an honorarium, you know, consider that to a clinical trial where you might come in three times a year for an hour. We wanted to make sure we reimburse them for appropriately for the time and dedication they were giving us. So the study protocol went like this. We enrolled about 156 drivers. We focused on people age 70 and over. At enrollment, we did the baseline vision battery, which I'll describe in a moment, which will be very similar to the one I previously described for the 2000 person study. And during that visit is when the DAS, the driver acquisition system, was actually installed in their vehicle. We made sure it was working correctly, and then we sent them out and they lived their life for 6 months. We called them a few times to see how things were going. We also had, we worked with Virginia Tech on this, and the device had a health check about every 2 weeks to make sure it was still working. So if the device was not working, we basically could have them come in or go to their home and replace the device. At the end of the 6 months, we confirmed what their vision was like just to make sure that somebody didn't have an acute event and their vision suddenly got worse and the DAS was deinstalled. So what did we focus on? We focused on many things. That's not mine. I think I have it on silent. We focused on many things in this study, but what I'm going to describe to you is our study examining the association in vision impairment in the VIP study and crashes and near crashes. And we published this last fall in the Journal of American Medical Association Ophthalmology. So in terms of the sample demographics, most of the people were in their 70s and 80s, although we had a couple in the 90s. Again, the same distribution, about 20% Black, about 80% white. The men and women were equally represented. They had a better range of education than Sharp 2. Their cognitive status was also normal, and they were not depressed. Depression can also cause problems in driving. And you can see here examples of the different types of vision impairment, different types of eye diagnosis we found in our sample. Our sample was not designed to look at the association between eye diseases and collision involvement or near collision involvement. That would have taken a very different types of study design with many more patients. What we're focused in on is the relationship between vision impairment from these conditions and crash and near crash involvement. So as you can see here, the middle column is N and the last column is percent. And you can see that we're experiencing, basically we do have vision impairment in our sample. And we only had three drivers with visual acuity worse than 20/40. So probably not gonna be able to use the sample to look at visual acuity using naturalistic driving techniques. But I'll just point that out. I think people, as I mentioned early, screen themselves off the road, are screened off the road by their maybe healthcare provider, or just for some reason, the family asks them not to drive. So here we'll look at the age-adjusted associations between baseline visual function and at fault and near crash involvement. And basically what we found, very similar to the accident report study, we've confirmed using naturalistic driving techniques that contrast sensitivity deficits and slowing in visual processing speed, also impaired motion perception we looked at in this study. And that also was associated with collision involvement. Again, I'll emphasize, except for slowed visual processing speed, which is actually a rate ratio of 5, which is quite high, these risks are typically low, but they statistically exist. So in summary, using naturalistic driving methods, we identified three types of vision impairment, as I just summarized. The strengths of this approach was that we avoided the biases of vehicle accident reports. We used a combined outcome of crashes and near crashes. Early naturalistic driving studies in older adults were only defined by rapid acceleration and deceleration. They weren't not defined by video. So this is a real clear step forward for our study. The limitations, it's a relatively small sample. Compare it to the accident report study with 2000 drivers. Impaired visual acuity could not really be evaluated. And the study, as I mentioned, was not really designed to understand crash risk by ocular diagnostic category. So naturalistic driving studies, like I've just described, I think is a very exciting method. And I think these methods going forward, more and more researchers around the country and also in other parts of the world are using these methods to understand how older drivers obtain visual information from the driving environment and how that impairment interferes with this process of driving. Vision screening, as I mentioned earlier in answer to one of the questions, may be effective for subgroups of drivers with a high risk of collision involvement. But at vision screening at a population basis, based on our study, is not really recommended. So current vision acuity screening laws may unduly penalize older drivers by removing people from the road who are not really unsafe. Consider the negative impact of driving cessation on older drivers. One of the big consequences of forcing somebody to stop driving, and over three or four prospective population-based studies, we've shown that driving cessation leads to incident depression. And so it really affects quality of life in an important way. So going back to the naturalistic driving study, what I wanna do is show you, if I can find the cursor. Okay, so let me set this up. This is a gentleman in the VIP study. The technology at the time was from 2009, so the video is grainy. The types of naturalistic driving we do now has much better quality video. But this is an example of a crash. I'll give you the tell you ahead of time, it involves a person. They were not injured. However, it did involve a crash, and I'd like you to see it. I just want to make sure you understand that we have the permission to show these slides for educational purposes. So here it goes. He's at an intersection in Birmingham, and he's just waiting there at the red light. And any moment now, he starts to move, and he runs into a person. So that's an example of a crash. And interestingly enough, in the case, and he looks flabbergasted, and she waves him on. So she said she wasn't hurt. She basically walked into the vehicle as it was moving. He didn't have vision in his right eye, which may have contributed. Here's an example of an encounter. Here's an example of somebody who's using a cell phone, older lady who's using a cell phone, and she almost has a near crash. And if you look over in the top right, she's in two lanes of traffic. She's in the left lane, and there's a car off in the side of the road trying to pull in. And as she's playing with her cell phone, you can, if she was looking at the road, she would see that person. However, because she's looking at the cell phone, she actually misses it. Here we go. So watch closely in the upper right. A vehicle is going to come in from the right. There it is. And she, what the funny part is, even though she realized that was not a good thing that happened, she continues to use the cell phone. She continues to use the cell phone. And I thank you for your attention. Yes, I'll try to talk directly into my
Brian. Yeah, thank you so much. That was really awesome work. And just tons of interesting thoughts about it. But did you look at like cell phone use as a risk factor and how that compares to some of the visual impairment? Like the different, how, you know, those were relatively low risk. I imagine cell phone risk might be much higher. But.
Yeah, that's an interesting question. With 155 people, we really didn't have the statistical power to address those types of questions. I think that question is fascinating. A question that we did look at using SHARP 2 data, it wasn't with the VIP data set, but with a much larger data set we were studying. In that sample, there were about 700 people who were age 70 and over. And in that data set, there were many types of ways driving could be distracted. It could be eating something, it could be putting on eye makeup, it could be doing something in the side seat or trying to attend to a child in the back seat, as well as using cell phones. And what we found in that study is all these distracted driving behaviors, if you took them collectively, did not elevate collision risk. However, the cell phone did. It was about four times the rate of collision involvement in that large study. So I think the cell phone use is just a really fascinating topic. And I think many people have used simulators, also other types of population-based studies where they use accident reports and they can tell the time the call went in on the cell phone and they put the two sources of information together. But I think really the naturalistic driving studies could really address that question in much more detail.
With your, obviously visual acuity wasn't a big factor on this. With visual field loss, you know, there's quite a bit of glaucoma in your population. Should we be screening for that more? At least in my population, younger population, RP, once we're having crashes, they have these visual field, these patches of visual field loss. They're not seeing pedestrians up there. It's hard. And that's hard that you can evaluate that by our standard test.
I think in the clinic, those are very important screening methods. Because as their ophthalmologist, you need to make recommendations to them about driving. The problem is there's not a lot of what I would call highly quantified information from the literature that says, well, how big does the scotoma have to be? Or how much of the periphery has to be involved before they're more dangerous? So I wish I could answer your question. I encourage you to screen all your patients for that clinically. At a population level, it's not going to be useful clinically. I think it could.
Dr. Allison, Robert Christensen, I've been involved in working with visual impaired. Oh my gosh, it's probably 45 years since residency. And I want to thank you so much for the work you've done. This is not a popular thing to be looking at. People perceive driving as a right, not a privilege. And Medical Advisory Board stresses that it is a privilege to drive and not a right that they have. So your work is wonderful. You spent years doing this. Thank you very much for doing it. You're very kind and dedicating yourself to this approach to helping us understand this stuff. I think that's wonderful. My question is that you mentioned that one of the important things is visual processing speed or visual processing ability. Is that relatable to anything we see clinically? We don't normally test the visual processing ability, and it seems to want to be one of the chief factors that you're looking at.
Excellent question. Thank you for your earlier comments. In ophthalmology, it's not evaluated. It's more so evaluated in neurology, where you see cognitive factors. You can have slow visual processing speed and not have mild cognitive impairment or dementia, something that seems to be common with growing old. The brain moves more slowly. I don't think it would really be appropriate for ophthalmologists to screen for that. However, what many states have done, and we did this for over 25 years at UAB, with a driving assessment clinic, where if an ophthalmologist, neurologist, or even an internist, in any, we even had referrals from neurological surgery, where they noticed that their patients might have deficits that impact driving, they would refer them to the driving rehabilitation clinic, assessment clinic. And the OT and the certified driving rehab specialist would evaluate them both in clinic and also on the road and make a recommendation back to a physician. And in those types of clinics, driving assessment rehabilitation clinics, visual processing speed is, I would say, almost always assessed because it is really one of the most potent visual cognitive risk factors in older drivers for collision failure.
Thank you so much. We do have an excellent vision rehabilitation program which analyzes the things associated with this facility, and they do an excellent job where there's a question. Thank you.
I was just wondering about the implementation of your techniques, driving techniques on a cost basis. You know, we're trying to do this, everywhere.
So this is a question, what are the financial implications of doing naturalistic driving type assessment? It's very expensive. We have 4 to 5 channel videos. Many times we had to go out and fix the vehicles, the video got loose, or the other kinematic variable technologies weren't working right. To give you an idea, to study 156 drivers, we studied more than crashes, it was $3.5 million. So it's a very expensive approach. The Sharp 2 study, which I mentioned, was on the 3,500 drivers on like 6 locations. I mean, millions and millions and millions of dollars. Again, U.S. Department of Transportation funded all of that. So using it as an assessment tool, I think the way it exists today would not really be recommended. However, for doing studies, if you can identify the resources, this was funded by the National Eye Institute. If we funded it, if you can get them funded, it would be very worthwhile because it provides a level of data you just don't even get from all the other techniques I described.
Would it, because it's, you know, right now cost prohibitive, obviously, if your study say that something that's less costly might be a good thing, like having a driver specialist at a certain age, you know, kind of test people.
Absolutely. I think the way most clinics work, is that when they refer the patient, it's exactly that type of person. We have specialists and occupational therapists who actually does a clinic assessment of risk factors that are important for clinician involvement, but then they also take them on the road and use a variety of things, checklists. They're mostly in the form of checklists with Likert scales, and they do their evaluation. The problem with basing a licensing decision only on that is it's usually a short snapshot of driving. It might be an hour. Some clinics might do, you know, 3 to 4 visits. It really just depends on how the clinic set up. The other challenge in the clinic is that driving is not considered an instrumental activity of daily living by Medicare. In some states, they've manipulated it such that it will be reimbursed, but in most states, it's a cash operation. And that really prevents older drivers who have various medical conditions, particularly visual or cognitive impairments, even motor impairments, for going for the assessments because they pay for them themselves. And the prices range, and I've been privy to a lot of people's clinics, and it can vary anywhere from like $250 to $500 to $600. And for an older adult, that can be prohibitive.
I think it's unfortunate, right? Because of having, you know, seen a couple of kids that were close to our family actually killed in by driving older drivers, I kind of I feel that older people, and I'm getting to that age myself, that, you know, 70 or something, should be retested, just like we're tested when we're 16, 17 to get that license. I kind of think I should be something older people, but anyway, I know that's very controversial.
Yeah, your point is well taken. We actually did a survey in the state of Florida asking for mandatory, and Florida did not have mandatory visual acuity rescreening up until maybe 10 years ago. They instituted it. Before they did that, we did a survey and asked them whether they would mind coming in for a visual acuity screening test. And the vast majority were fine with it. So there's a lot of controversy about it. There's controversy from a public policy standpoint of state affording to do all that for all the older drivers. People live a long time now. And then there's basically, from everything I've told you today, visual acuity is not really the acid test here.
No, it's not. I think the driving is just ideas.
Did you look at any methodologies for testing glare? And is glare tested in the vision rehab?
The question is, did we look at evaluating disability glare? And do the driving assessment clinics use disability glare testing? I think some of them do. I think it depends where they come from. Some of the driving assessment clinics are more focused on cognitive issues and visual issues. But for example, when we had our clinic, we had to close it recently. But when we had our clinic, we did evaluate that. One of the problems, if you look at the large studies done over, say, the past 20 years on visual
affects the visual function that elevate crash risk using accident reports primarily. This highlighted glare itself isn't really the acid test. It causes a problem for older drivers, and I'll tell you that in questionnaires, but for some reason studies, it's not really revealed as a risk. However, contrast sensitivity, which is also often the way you measure disability glare, is revealed. For example, we did a study in the early 2000s looking at people who underwent cataract surgery and people who had cataracts but chose not to. This was in the mid-90s. And we found that cataract surgery actually reduces collision risk in adults age 60 and over. And the primary reason that this was the case is the improvement in contrast sensitivity. So I can't really answer your question about glare. It's kind of a weirdness in the literature, but contrast sensitivity is important, and it's usually how we measure glare, although it often be improved visual acuity.
I have one last question. So you mentioned, you know, when it comes to collisions and the ones you were able to monitor, was there certain times of the day where they were more likely to happen? Was there any possible association with specific type of visual impairment? And could that potentially be used to, you know, instead of, you know, stopping someone from driving completely, reducing, you know, after selecting a period of time where it's actually most likely for them to have a collision?
So the question is, do the collisions we see in any of these studies tend to occur at a certain time of day? And would it be appropriate to recommend, for example, day driving? So keep in mind, many states do have those sorts of regulations for day driving for certain types of individuals, but not just vision problems, maybe cognitive issues. It's really interesting when you look at the collision literature, particularly if you're focusing on age 70 and above, almost all the collisions are during the day. And think about the lifestyles of older adults. They're active during the day. They're not going to work. They're probably not staying out late at night. And so we have a really hard time addressing the question of are the visual risk factors at night different in terms of examining them as compared to during the day. So we just can't answer the question, but I'll make a comment that what happens with older drivers is the first thing they start self-regulating on their own is night driving. They start to minimize it, and in some older drivers, they stop it. And they drive during the day. And because of that, it interferes with the ability to address that question. But important thing I haven't really discussed here, we've done a lot of research on self-regulation. Self-regulation in older adults is a very important thing. They do it. It's the ones that don't you worry about.
Well, thank you very much.
Thank you.